first, thanks to the worship team for leading us in those amazing songs, highlighting our dependence and our faith in God. Obviously, you can see that this is a new setup on our sanctuary this morning. We've never done this before. When we were setting this up, Sebastiano and Joel were arguing about who got to sit on the right and who sat on the left. I told them they really don't understand what they're asking. And it wasn't mine to give them anyway. So it's good to be with you this morning, even if it is in this very different setting. We made a decision this week not to answer the questions that came to us during that time of Back to the Basics, that series. We are committed to answering those questions. They were very heartfelt questions. And when it's appropriate, when we're back together, we will do that. But it just seemed like today we just need to focus on what's going on around us and just share from our hearts. And so each one of us has picked a scripture and some words of meditation. We may interrupt each other. We don't know how this is going to go exactly. But we just want to share from our hearts this morning. The passage that I selected this morning is from 1 Peter 2, verses 9 through 10. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, so that you may declare the praises of the one who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Peter was writing to a church in crisis, to a church that was suffering intense persecution. And I love how he says, this is who you are. Listen, church, this is who we are. A chosen people, a royal priesthood, God's special possession. And I love especially that last one. We are God's special possession, and we are precious in his sight, and therefore we place our trust and our hope and our faith in God our Father. It is in times like this that I think kind of all of our independence gets stripped away. And it is an opportunity for us to relearn in new ways our total dependence upon God. We don't and can't place our ultimate trust in a government. I certainly can't place it on myself. We can't place our trust in money. All of those things can crumble, but there's one place that we can place our ultimate and total trust, and that is with God, because God is still on the throne. You know, weeks like this, what is happening around us right now, it just lays out our human limitations and our human weaknesses. They're just laid bare in front of us for our eyes to see, really for the whole world to see. And then it is a response of where do we place our trust? And to whom do we belong? We belong to God. We are his special possession. And we are a royal priesthood. What does a priest do? Since Jesus came, priests go directly to God. We don't have to go through an earthly priest. We don't have to go through a pastor. It doesn't matter if we're in our home or if we're outside. It doesn't matter where we're at. We can go directly to God in prayer and in intercession. We are a priesthood of all believers. We are a royal priesthood, Peter says. And so we have this joy and we have this responsibility to share Christ with each other and to share Christ to the world. And another very critical role of priest is prayer and intercession. Since we are all priests, each and every one of us, it is our responsibility and it's really our privilege to be able to just bring our lives to God, to bring our neighbors' lives to God, to bring our community and our world and just center it on God's throne. In thinking about this, I thought, you know, if the church doesn't do this, if God's own special possession won't come to him in prayer, who will? And if we, as a royal priesthood, will not come to God now, when will we? If what we see happening around us today doesn't just drive us to our knees, I don't know what would. I think maybe it's because our son Casey is in Italy with Samaritan's Purse as a nurse today. But this week, God has laid, I think in a very special way on my heart, the need to pray for our nurses and our doctors, those who are risking their lives every time they go to work, to care for us. And I think as we pray for them, really we also should listen to them. I think the most pointed message that I've seen on my TV screen this week was, you know, this image of some medical personnel. I think most of them are probably nurses. They have the mask, they have the gown, they have the gloves, and they hold up this sign that says, "We are going to work for you. Please stay home for us." They're just asking us to do our part. One more line in this passage that I just want to highlight for us. "So that you might declare the praise of the one who's called you out of darkness." Another translation says, "So that you may proclaim the marvelous acts of the one who's called you out of darkness." And the one that I really love says, "This is so you can show the goodness of God, of the one who called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light." To show the goodness of God. As God's special possession, this is our call. To show to the world the goodness of God. Whenever there's large tragedies or calamities, sicknesses, There are Christians, and this always comes out of, well, this is God's punishment. And I wonder about that message that we're sending to the world. For myself, personally, I prefer to say, let's just show the goodness of God in the midst of this crisis. Let's just be an example that peace comes from faith in God. That eternal assurance, that this ultimate assurance that we have in Jesus, the promise that we have of a loving God who cares for us and has promised to be with us no matter what comes. And this is our opportunity to shine the light of Jesus straight into the darkness. Philippians 2:15 says, "Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life." And I think this is our challenge. To show the goodness of God and to shine brightly. As royal priests, let's bring peace where there is no peace. May we bring comfort to those who are hurting. May we be patient and listen to those who are anxious. May we bring hope into a world of desperation. And may we bring Jesus into the darkest places. And church, let's shine. Let's shine brightly like the stars while we hold on firmly to the word of life. Amen.
I just want to say that I'm so thankful to be here with, you know, we didn't come up with a name or anything. We could be the Three Amigos or something like that. But I've really been blessed by, during this season, to be with this group that we've just come together and praying together, trying to seek ways of doing ministry in new ways that none of us had ever thought about before. And we met Friday, for example. We Zoomed in together with the board and just shared for over an hour different ways that we could minister. And people are stepping up in this congregation. And it's just so exciting to see how we're willing not to shrink back out of fear, but willing to do ways of ministry, like I said, we've never done before. And so I said it last week, and I'll say it again, I'm thankful for technology, because we can do things with technology that wouldn't allow us to meet, like we're meeting, for example, right now. And We're going to continue to pray together. I know Sunday school classes are Zooming in together. And prior to a few years ago, I thought Zooming meant we were flying around in space somewhere. But grateful that we can get online together and share and pray and lift each other up. So this morning, I want to continue a similar theme. It's a different passage. But some of the thoughts that Pastor Terry shared, I'd like to share through a passage in Matthew. So in Matthew 7, starting at verse 24. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. So this passage, interesting enough, is at the end of a very important sermon that Jesus taught. It's a sermon that most scholars would say it's the greatest message ever preached. Professors in Bible college and seminary would say it's the greatest lecture ever taught. And it's the Sermon on the Mount, a passage that we're all familiar with. In Matthew 5, 6, and then at 7. And then at the end of 7, it's the end of this message, he says, therefore. It's a new way of looking at things Jesus is saying. Everything that I taught, I want you to listen right now because it's important in terms of moving forward. The first thing he says in this passage is that there's going to be storms. We will go through difficult times. The rain will come. The rain will be heavy. I remember a couple of years ago, almost to this date, we were at a pastor's retreat, the Ivana pastor's retreat, part of the fellowship of Clinton Frame and a number of other churches. We were down in Florida. And it was in February, and if you recall, a couple of years ago, we had those floods. It rained so hard, and in the Goshen area and Napanee was literally flooded. And I remember Amy, my wife, calling and said, the basement is 6 inches in water. And all I could say was, yeah, it's terrible weather here, too. And she said, you're lying. And I said, yes, I am, and I'm sorry, but I can't do anything from here, but we'll work it out. But that was a difficult time. Those rains that came and flooded our basement. And Jesus says, we will have difficult times. We will go through storms. And yet, he says, there are two ways of responding. And Terry talked about how it's important that we respond in a way that we can share this with the community. Because the foolish way, he says, of responding is that everything will just crash. Everything will fall apart. And he says the foolish ones are the ones that don't apply what Jesus taught. So when you look at Matthew 5 and 6 and the rest of 7, Jesus taught a lot of important things. And yet he says the foolish ones are the ones that will not apply these in their lives. So I think some will look at different ways of trying to build a faith, trying to build a foundation for their lives that will get them through. And when everything's going great, that can happen. Your income from your paycheck, when life is good, that's good too. You can buy material things. You can strive to have these material things, a lake cottage, a lake house, have a couple of vehicles, have all these wonderful things. And when life is going well, those things are great. But when we go through a storm of life, like we're going through right now, It doesn't matter if you have a mansion that you live in, does it? It doesn't matter if you have a brand new, beautiful Lamborghini. And you have to watch last week to get what I just said with the Lamborghini. But it doesn't matter when we have these material things. It doesn't matter when we have a great job where we're making a great income. When we're going through the storms of life like we're going now, these things don't matter. And so Jesus reminds us that the things that we can hold on to are the things that he taught us. And it's interesting that in these 110 verses, in these three chapters, there are about 20 different themes. And what he really emphasizes on are two things. First of all, the importance of prayer. Three different ways he mentions the importance of prayer in Matthew 5, 6, and 7. And Matthew 6, of course, is the example of how we should pray by teaching his disciples the Lord's Prayer. And then he also says the importance of fasting. Fasting is something that we decide to give up. Sometimes it's food, sometimes it's other things, and we set those aside and we decide that we're going to spend time in prayer with Jesus. And then thirdly, he says in chapter 7, knock, seek, ask. And this is a form of prayer that some of us think, oh my goodness, God wants me to beg. And what it really means is Jesus wants us to be in a prayerful relationship. So it means keep asking, keep talking to me about what you need, and share it with me. And this idea of praying is a way that brings us into a place of calmness and peace. Prayer, see, prayer benefits me, benefits those that I'm praying for, because God does respond. And it benefits our relationship with God as we talk and share with one another. And then Jesus also taught something else in this, on the Sermon on the Mount in chapter 7 when he says, don't worry. It's actually chapter 6, starting at verse 25. I'll read that for you. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life. I'm going to say that again. Therefore, in these times of troubles, in these days when we can be filled with fear and anxiety and worry, do not worry about your life, what you'll eat, what you'll drink, or about your body, what you'll wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? And then he says, almost tongue-in-cheek, can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your day? So those of us who build our house on God's foundation of his word, we have this foundation of prayer, spending time in prayer, spending time seeking God, spending time waiting and listening to God and receiving God's peace. And then we also have this time of no worries, no anxiety, no fear, because God gives us that peace. And then the last thing I want to say, it doesn't really say it in those three verses that I read, but it's reading between the lines. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine, what about those who have not heard? What about those in our community? We've talked about it over the weeks and months, how there's these groups of people that we call the duns and the nuns, and maybe some of you are listening even this morning. Maybe you started in church years ago, but you're done. And perhaps you're a nun. Perhaps you're someone who's never attended church. You live right here in the U.S. You live right here in these counties around Goshen, Middlebury, Millersburg. But you've never attended church. You're a nun. And it's important for us in the church to, if ever before, to let our light shine. For those around us, that we can share our peace. For those around us, that we can share practically. And our prayer is that those of you who would classify as nuns and duns would see that there can be a peace that you've never experienced before by sharing your faith and opening up your heart to the one who loves you and cares about you. So may God continue to speak to us and grant us that peace in these coming days. Amen.
Well, as I've been thinking about what's sort of transpired over the last few weeks and leading up to this time, you know, I always think of stories within the scriptures when there is a massive sort of social upheaval or big times of uncertainty. And just to represent our Old Testament text this morning, I wanted to share with you just sort of an overview of the story of out of the book of Exodus. Now, for those of you that are not familiar, the book of Exodus is really the story of Israel coming out of slavery after 440 years of oppression under Egypt. And countless lessons can come to us from this book, but the one that I really want to focus on this morning is that even in the midst of God forming a people and calling them out of a way of life and into a new reality, he's always remembering the other, and he's always calling his people to remember the other as well. Through a large series of signs and wonders and things that God performs in front of the Egyptians, in front of Egyptian leadership, and as Moses, his servant, is going to the king of Egypt and calling for initially just the ability for the Hebrew people to worship. This is the initial call. Let them go into the desert and worship. And again, they are denied. And so God will deliver his people. But in doing so, he's going to also deliver a few of the Egyptians, which I think is a really interesting thing to think about. We often think of the Old Testament as being the story of, you know, it's all about the Israelites, and it's about their story and how they're formed and how they're brought out of slavery and into new opportunities and into God's goodness and his grace and his mercy. And then they, you know, at various times they pull away or fall away from God. But in the story of Exodus, we're only a short way in, and God is already talking about the other. So in Exodus 14, we see the crossing of the Red Sea. So the people of God, is the Israelites, the Hebrews at this time, are taken out of Egypt. And they are about ready to cross into a new land. And there's just so much fear. The people of Israel are saying, is it because that there were not enough graves in Egypt that you have brought us out here to die? I mean, things like this, the uncertainty, even though they are free, even though they have seen the wonders of God, there's always a temptation to doubt his goodness, to doubt his provision, to doubt that he will do the things that he said he will do. And so as God is preparing his people to leave, he says, hey, all of you who are receiving freedom today, remember the foreigner among you, for you too were once foreigners in a strange land. Remember, remember, remember. Always remember the foreigner. Remember the outsider. Remember the person that is not part of your faith community, because you have something to teach them. This story that is unfolding for you has something to teach them. And so this begins in chapter 12. They are told to remember the foreigner. They will cross over the Red Sea and experience this really great act of deliverance. And then Moses will say these just powerful words in Exodus 15. He says, beginning in verse 1, I will sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. The horse and its rider he has hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him, my father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. And what amazing words of assurance. I mean, Moses proclaims this over the people, and yet only a short time later, they're left doubting again. Because their normal way of life, even though they were in captivity, their normal way of life is challenged and threatened. And they find themselves in completely different circumstances than they ever have before. And God will continue to provide for them on a day-to-day basis, which I think is a really important thing to point out. He doesn't store up for them months and or weeks and months of food and provision. It is a day-to-day provision that he provides. And if people try to store up and to hoard and to stockpile, he removes what they have stored up from them. This is really important when we're thinking about how we're being spiritually formed right now in this season as a country. Obviously, we've seen the pictures of empty shelves in our stores, and we've had this kind of sense of urgency and the scarcity. But God provides. God provides day to day. We hear in the Lord's Prayer, what? Give us this day our, not weekly bread, not yearly bread, but daily bread. This is how God provides for us. And so even in doing all of this, even his daily provision, there is always this doubt, but there is always continuing to be a focus on remember the other. Past chapters 15, 16, 17, we again see in Exodus 19 where God will say, remember the foreigner. Remember those that are among you. Treat them well. And why should you treat them well? Because you know what it's like to be in uncertain circumstances. You remember how that feels. And the difference is that you have me, where the foreigner doesn't. The foreigner does not know God the way you know me. So be mindful of them. And the thing that I keep on coming back to time and time again is I really strongly believe that when the Exodus occurred, that there were a small group, a small minority of people outside of the Hebrew nation, that there were indeed Egyptians that came out with the Israelites. And we see this because there's so many mentions of, hey, the foreigner dwelling among you. And you're like, well, what foreigner? Wasn't it just the Hebrews that came out? And why is that? I've just often thought that God's purpose seems to be that even in the midst of their oppression and their slavery, that their difficulty and coming out of difficulty was also for the benefit of others. So whatever struggles that we are experiencing today, whatever uncertainties, whatever doubts, whatever fears, just remember that God is with us. And he has called us to be a priesthood. He has called us to be a nation of priests, a holy nation, set apart, yes, to honor and worship God. Yes, to lift his name on high. Yes, to proclaim his goodness and his provision. But also to point those who do not know him to his goodness and his provision, to who he is as a God that saves. A God that enters in the midst of our fears, enters into the midst of the unknown, who provides for us. And so while we should certainly be reflecting personally, that we should be personally drawing near to God, I just want to invite us in this season, remember the other. Remember those who do not know Jesus. Remember those who might be struggling in our community, who may have some sort of shortness of resource, or who may be just lonely. Remember to reach out in the ways that we can, because we have been given an opportunity, even in the midst of our own uncertainty, to show Jesus to people, to be a voice of light in the midst of uncertain times. And I just, friends, I just believe that, as Pastor Amanda said earlier, this season that we're in is an opportunity. It was an opportunity for God's people when he first brought them out of captivity. This difficult seasons were an opportunity for Jesus' disciples when they encountered many uncertainties. And today, what we face is an opportunity for God to be revealed, for his goodness and his provision to be revealed to the world. And so may we be that kind of people. That's my prayer for each and every one of us.
A word that Joel used a lot there was remember. And through the Old Testament, we see that over and over again. Remember, remember, remember.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. 10 years from now, 50 years from now, how will we remember this experience? Mm-hmm. How will we remember God's goodness and God's grace and God's power? What will our children say? What will our children tell their children about, this is what your grandparents did during this time of difficulty. This is what our church was about. Mm-hmm. So we seek to know what we can learn and how we can live into this, fully believing and trusting in God. But to me, it's just a challenge to think, how will we be remembered by the future generations when they talk about this period?
Amen.
Do you have anything, Sebastiano, you want to add?
I don't think I have any more to add. This has been good, and yeah. I've learned just
I hope it's been good for them.
Yeah. We don't often get to sit in such comfort and talk about the Bible with each other. This is pretty great. So I like it.
Yeah. I do want to say just God's blessings on each of our households. Mm-hmm. And again, if you have need, if you want prayer, just whatever it is, please contact us. And also, we know that there, from last week's experience, there are people viewing that are not a part of our body. You know, if you have a prayer request, go to our webpage. Let us know if you have a need. I just invite you to go to our Facebook page and let us know what that is. And let us respond to you.
Amen.
Anything else?
I would just say, obviously, for students and young adults, again, if there's any way that I can be in touch with you or we can be connecting, there will be various messages and kind of devotionals and some teachings for our high school and middle school youth in particular. Just invite everybody to engage in that content. And again, just as Pastor Terry said, if we can pray for anything specifically or just connect in any way. We're getting pretty proficient at the Zoom meeting and the live streaming and all of that, and I think we can just use those tools to connect as best we can. So,
I do know that one of our Sunday school classes this morning was meeting on Zoom, and now that's one of our younger classes. But it is something that, you know, I actually told Dwayne this week, you know, I think as we go through this period, we're going to learn a lot of different ways that we can use technology in really positive ways. So I would invite the worship team to come up for the song. Sebastiano, if you would just lead us in a prayer.
Yes. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that in this day of challenges and difficulties, we can rest in you. Father, you tell us that we are your royal priests. We are your servants. We are your children. And we can find peace in you as we continue to come to you, bringing you our needs and our concerns as we come as individuals, as we come as households and families. We thank you that we can find your peace and we can receive your wisdom. And we can also be empowered to care for one another in new ways. So I pray that you would spur us on to reach out to those around us through technology, through ways that we can be friends and family to one another in these days. And we thank you for the empowerment that we receive in your spirit. And we thank you for the love that we receive from you that we can also share with others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.